Welcome to the RSET online session. I am Dr. Rinku Jacob from the Department of Basic Sciences and Humanities, Rajagiri School of Engineering and Technology. I will be discussing the first experiment in the course Engineering Physics Lab. The name of the experiment is the electrical oscillator. This experiment is from the syllabus for first year engineering students of the circuit branch. The aim of this experiment are: firstly, to study the effect of damping on an electrical forced harmonic oscillator using the frequency response graph. Here we take series LCR circuit with a periodic voltage source as the forced electrical oscillator. Secondly, to quantify the variation in the frequency response curves produced by change in damping parameter using the quantifier called as quality factor or Q factor. Now let me explain the details of the apparatus we use for doing this experiment. One of the devices is the LCR trainer kit and the connecting wires with the banana connectors. The other device is a signal or function generator and the BNC Q9 to dual alligator or crocodile clip with test lead prop cable. Now I will give you the details of the LCR trainer kit. As you can see in the image, the LCR trainer kit contains three different values of resistors, that is 47 ohm, 100 ohm and 150 ohm, and three different capacitors, that is 0.1 microfarad, 0.22 microfarad and 0.33 microfarad, and one inductor of 30 millihenry. An ammeter and a voltmeter is also included in the kit. Both can read AC current and AC voltage respectively. This is the magnified image of the ammeter scale in the LCR trainer kit. The ammeter can give readings of current in the circuit in the range from 0 to 50 milliampere. To make the observation of current using this ammeter, first we should know the least count of this ammeter. The smallest reading that can be taken using the device is called least count of that device. To find the least count, we take the ratio between the difference of any marked reading on the scale and the number of divisions in between the selected readings. Here we take the first marked reading on the scale, that is 0 milliampere, and the next marked reading, that is 10 milliampere. The difference between these two marked readings is taken as the numerator in the equation. So 10 milliampere minus 0 milliampere. And the number of divisions between 0 milliampere and 10 milliampere is 10 divisions. This is taken as the denominator. So the ratio between them gives 10 milliampere by 10, which is 1 milliampere. And this is the least count of the ammeter we use in the LCR trainer kit. This is the magnified image of the voltmeter scale. The voltmeter can give readings of voltage in the circuit in the range from 0 to 10 volt. For making measurements using this voltmeter, here also we need to find the least count of this voltmeter. To find the least count, we again take the ratio between the difference of any marked reading on the scale and the number of markings between the selected readings. Here we take the first marked reading on the scale, that is 0 volt, and the next marked reading, that is 2 volt. The difference between these two marked readings is taken as the numerator in the equation. So 2 volt minus 0 volt. The number of divisions between 0 volt and 2 volt is 10 division. This is taken as the denominator. So the ratio between them gives 2 volt by 10, which is 0.2 volt. So the least count of the voltmeter is 0.2 volt. These are the connecting wires used in the LCR trainer kit. The second device, which is a part of the experimental setup, is a signal or function generator. This is basically an oscillator that produces different type of electronic signals like sine, square, triangular, pulses, etc. The signal produced can be obtained from the output port using the BNC connector cable. the output has 50 ohm impedance, and the maximum output voltage from this port is 20 VPP. VPP stands for peak to peak voltage. The maximum frequency this oscillator can generate is 1 MHz. The frequency of the generator signal can be varied using the knob named as frequency variability. And the amplitude of the signal can be varied using the knob amplitude variability. The type of signal can be selected using the function button. For this experiment, we select the signal to be as sine wave. The output from the signal generator is taken using the BNC Q9 to dual alligator or crocodile clips with test lead prop cable. Now let us look into the theory behind this experiment. Before discussing about the electrical oscillator, which is a forced harmonic oscillator, first we need to understand what is the difference between a simple harmonic oscillator, a damped harmonic oscillator, and a forced harmonic oscillator. These oscillators or system can be mechanical or electrical in nature. For a comparison between the nature of mechanical and electrical oscillators, first we begin with the mechanical oscillator. For that, we consider a mechanical system with a mass attached to a spring. Initially, the mass is at equilibrium position as shown in the figure. Now, if we apply an external force F, the mass is displaced from its equilibrium position and makes a displacement X. Then there is a restoring force acting on the mass, which is against the displacement of the mass from its equilibrium position. In classical mechanics, if a body experiences a restoring force F restore when it is displaced from its equilibrium position, and if the restoring force is proportional to its displacement X, then the system is called as a harmonic oscillator. And if F is the only force acting on the body, then the body is said to be a simple harmonic oscillator. The restoring force is given by F restore equal to minus Kx, where K is the spring or force constant. In the equilibrium condition, that the applied force is balanced by the restoring force, we write F equal to minus Kx. By Newton's second law, we can write the force as the product of mass and acceleration. So in differential form, m into d square x by dt square equal to minus kx. Dividing throughout by m on both sides and rearranging, we get d square x by dt square plus k by m into x equal to 0. This is the differential equation for a body executing simple harmonic motion or oscillation. Now we assume the entire setup is immersed in a tank containing any fluid with a damping coefficient denoted by B. For motions of the mass with small velocities through the damping medium, there is a damping force acting on the mass, which is proportional to the velocity. So the damping force is F damp equal to minus BV. The negative sign indicates the force is opposite to displacement of the mass, and B is the damping coefficient of the damping medium. The restoring force is F restore equal to minus Kx. So under equilibrium condition, the damping force and the restoring force balances the applied force. That is, applied force F equal to damping force F damp plus restoring force F restore, or F equal to minus BV minus Kx. In differential form, the force F can be written as mass into acceleration, that is m into d square x by dt square, and the velocity as dx by dt. So we get m into d square x by dt square equal to minus b into dx by dt minus kx. On rearranging, we get the equation डी स्क्वायर एक्स बाय डी टी स्क्वायर प्लस बी बाय एम इंटू डी एक्स बाय डी टी प्लस के बाय एम इंटू एक्स इक्वल टू जीरो. दिस इज द डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन फॉर ए डैम्ड मैकेनिकल हार्मोनिक ऑसिलेटर. दिस डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन कैन बी मॉडिफाइड एज डी स्क्वायर एक्स बाय डी टी स्क्वायर प्लस टू बीटा इंटू डी एक्स बाय डी टी प्लस ओमेगा जीरो स्क्वायर इंटू एक्स इक्वल टू जीरो. Here B by M is replaced by a constant called 2 beta and it is the damping produced on unit mass and is called as the damping constant. Also K by M is replaced by omega 0 square and it is the restoring force acting on unit mass. So damping constant beta is related to the damping ability of the medium on the oscillating mass and omega zero is related to the restoring ability of the oscillator. Based on the values of beta and omega zero, there are three different cases for the motion of the mass through the damping medium. Firstly, when beta is greater than omega zero, that is when the damping is more compared to the restoring ability of the oscillator. This condition is called overdamped case. Under this condition, the mass will not be oscillating or making to and fro motion. Instead, its displacement gradually decreases exponentially with time and comes to rest. Secondly, beta equal to omega zero. That is, when the damping ability of the medium is equal to the restoring ability of the oscillator. Under this condition also, there will not be any oscillation. And the displacement of the mass will gradually decreases exponentially with time and comes to rest. But in this condition, the exponential decay of the displacement of mass to the equilibrium point will be much faster compared to the overdamped case. This condition is called as critical damped case. And the third case is when beta is less than omega zero. That is, when the damping is less on the oscillator compared to its own ability to retain the oscillation. This condition is called as underdamped case. In this case, the oscillator, which is the mass hanged in the spring, can make to and fro motion. But due to the presence of damping, the amplitude of oscillation will decrease exponentially with time. Also, the frequency of oscillation will be less than the natural frequency, or the frequency when there is no damping for the oscillator. The new frequency is called reduced frequency and it is given by omega equal to omega root of omega zero square minus beta square. The figure shows the displacement time graph for overdamped, critical damped and underdamped case. In the case of a damped harmonic oscillator, the oscillation will stop after a given time. So in order to sustain the oscillation, there should be an external periodic force which helps to retain the oscillation even in the presence of damping. Such a damped harmonic system onto which the external periodic force is acted is known as forced harmonic oscillator. Here the applied periodic force is denoted by f of t equal to f0 sin omega ft, where omega f is the angular frequency of the external periodic force. Under equilibrium, the net force acting on the mass is the sum of damping force, restoring force and the periodic force. So f equal to f damp plus f restore plus f of t, or f equal to minus bv minus kx plus f0 sin omega ft. In differential form, d square x by dt square plus b by m into dx by dt plus k by m into x equal to f0 by m into sin omega ft, where f0 by m is the external force acting per unit mass. And this is the differential equation for a forced harmonic mechanical oscillator. Now we can look into the series LCR circuit with an external periodic voltage source. As you can see in the figure, The series LCR circuit is formed by connecting an inductor of inductance L, a resistor of resistance R, and a capacitor of capacitance C in series with a periodic voltage source given by V of t equal to V0 sin omega ft. The voltage produced by the source is shared between the L, R, and C components. So the potential drop across the inductor L is VL equal to L into di by dt, and that across the resistor R is VR equal to I into R, and across the capacitor is VC equal to Q by C. Here I is the current and Q is the charge stored in the capacitor at any instant of time. Now applying Kirchhoff's loop rule to the circuit, we write the sum of potential drops across the components L, C and R is equal to the applied voltage, that is the voltage of the source, that is VL plus VR plus VC equal to V0 sin omega ft. So writing the potential difference values into the equation, we get L into di by dt plus I into R plus Q by C equal to V0 sin omega ft. Here, current I is the rate of flow of charge with respect to time. So I equal to dQ by dt. So using this value in the above equation, we get L into d by dt of dQ by dt plus R into dQ by dt plus Q by C equal to V0 sin omega ft. Or L into d square Q by dt square plus R into dQ by dt plus Q by C equal to V0 sin omega ft. Dividing both sides of the equation using the value of L, we get d square Q by dt square plus R by L into dQ by dt plus 1 by LC into Q equal to V0 by L into sin omega ft. This is the differential equation for a forced electrical oscillator. Comparing the differential equation for forced electrical oscillator and forced mechanical oscillator, we can see that both the equations are analogous to each other. So, series LCR circuit connected with a periodic voltage source is analogous to a forced mechanical oscillator. Now, replacing the parameter with the constants and on comparing, we get for the electrical oscillator 2 beta equal to R by L and omega 0 square equal to 1 by LC. And for the mechanical oscillator, 2 beta equal to B by M and omega 0 square equal to K by M. So the damping in electrical oscillator is by resistor, and the restoring ability of the oscillator takes place with the help of inductor and capacitor. In this experiment, we focus on the forced electrical oscillator. Now, we look in detail about the series LCR circuit. It has application in radio and communication engineering. It can be used to select a certain narrow range of frequencies from the total spectrum of ambient radio waves. For example, AM or FM radio with analog tuners use a LCR circuit to tune a radio frequency. The figure shows a simple LCR circuit used to tune a particular frequency or channel. Here, one end of the LCR circuit is connected in series with an antenna, and the other end is connected to ground. So when electromagnetic waves coming from different stations reaches the antenna, an induced voltage is developed in the antenna. We can consider the induced voltage as V of t equal to V0 sin omega ft. Omega f is the frequency at which a particular station transmits its signals. This voltage will induce a current in the circuit. By properly choosing the values of L and C, we can make the resonant frequency of the circuit equal to that of the station or channel frequency, so that the LCR circuit will allow to pass the current from that particular station or channel. The current from the other stations will be suppressed. This is how we tune the circuit to receive a particular station. Due to the damping produced by the resistor, the resonant frequency will be less than the natural frequency of the circuit. The resonant angular frequency in the presence of damping is given by omega r equal to root of omega 0 square minus 2 beta square. Here the value of omega 0 square and beta square can be obtained from the equation 2 beta equal to r by l and omega 0 square equal to 1 by lc. So using these values into this equation, we get omega r equal to root of 1 by lc minus 2 times beta square. Beta is r by 2l. So 2 into r by 2l all square. But if there is no damping, then beta will be equal to 0. This happens when there is no resistance in the circuit, as it is the element that produces damping. Then resonant frequency becomes equal to the frequency of the LC circuit. That means omega r equal to omega 0. That is equal to root of 1 by LC. For our experiment, instead of using antenna to produce the periodic voltage from the electromagnetic wave, we use a signal or function generator that produces the signal of desired amplitude and frequency. An AC ammeter is added to the LCR circuit in series with the components to measure the current produced by the voltage source, which is placed instead of the signal antenna receives from any stations. Also, a voltmeter is added in parallel to the circuit components. So instead of searching signals of different frequencies coming from different stations, we manually change the frequency of the signal produced and look for the response of the circuit. This response is observed in terms of current from the ammeter. So when we plot the current developed in the circuit for different signal frequencies, we will get a curve as shown in this figure. This is called as the frequency response curve. It is named so as it gives the information regarding the response of the LCR circuit to different signals. That is, when frequency of the signal is changed. The x-axis of this response graph is the frequency of the signal applied to the LCR circuit, and y-axis is the observed current in the ammeter that corresponds to signal with the respective frequency. It can be seen in the figure. The current in the circuit is maximum at a particular frequency called as a resonant frequency, and it is denoted by FR. When we apply signal of this frequency to the LCR circuit designed with a particular value of L, C and R, then the frequency of the LCR circuit becomes equal to that of the applied signal frequency. This condition is called as resonance. So the impedance of the circuit becomes minimum. That is equal to the resistance produced by the resistor only. So the current becomes maximum in the circuit. For all other values of applied signal frequency, for the same values of L, C and R, the current reduces and comes to minimum value. If the frequency of the applied signal is varied from a minimum value to some maximum value, that gives the frequency response curve as shown in the figure. And repeat the experiment for different values of resistances. For a demonstration, I am showing R equal to 5 ohm, 10 ohm and 20 ohm. When we use R equal to 5 ohm, the resistance or damping is less. So the response curve is very sharp. It is shown in red color. Now we do the experiment with R equal to 10 ohm. The resistance or damping is increased. So the current decreased in the circuit. So the sharpness of the curve is decreased. This means the spreading from the central frequency is increased. Now if we increase the resistance again to R equal to 20 ohm, then the curve is becoming flat. So it can be clearly seen that as the resistance or damping is increased, the sharpness of the response curve is decreased. Another important nature that can be observed is that as we increase the resistance or damping, the frequency at which the resonance occurs is shifting to low frequency side. This is because the angular resonant frequency equation for the LCR circuit is given by omega r equal to root of 1 by LC minus 2 into r by 2L all square. Or in terms of frequency, FR equal to root of 1 by LC minus 2 into R by 2L all square all divided by 2 pi. So when R is increased, the second term in the numerator of RHS will increase. So the difference between the first and second term decreases in the numerator. So the resonant frequency decreases. This is the explanation for the shift in the central or resonant frequency as we increase the damping or resistance. Visually, it may be possible to differentiate between the different response curves, but there should be a proper quantifier or measure to properly differentiate between the response curves. One such quantifier is called as the quality factor or Q factor. Now, we see how to calculate the quality factor from the frequency response graph. Let us take the frequency response curve as shown here. The quality factor is calculated as Q is equal to resonant frequency FR divided by bandwidth. Here, the resonant frequency is the frequency at which we obtain the maximum current in the circuit. To find the bandwidth, first we have to multiply the maximum current Imax with 0.707 or multiply with 1 by square root of 2. The resulting value of current is nothing but the current that gives half of maximum power in the power graph. Now mark this value of current on the y-axis. Draw a line parallel to the x-axis from this value of current. This line meets the response curve at two points. Now draw two lines parallel to the y-axis so that it meets on the x-axis. The point on the x or frequency axis less than resonant frequency is called as lower cutoff frequency, which is denoted by FL. And the other point is called as higher cutoff frequency, denoted by FH. The difference between the higher and lower cutoff frequency gives the bandwidth. Now I will explain the procedure for this experiment. This is the circuit diagram of a forced electrical oscillator that we have discussed. And it is nothing but it is a series LCR circuit with a voltage source which is periodic in nature. To make the connections easier, first of all we remove the periodic voltage source from the circuit. So resistor, inductor, capacitor, milliammeter, voltmeter and back to the resistor, all are connected in series. So as per the circuit diagram, we are going to make connections on the LCR trainer kit. The first component in the circuit diagram is a resistor of resistance 47 ohm. So I'll be choosing the 47 ohm resistance on the LCR trainer kit. So there are two terminals for the 47 ohm resistor. So I'll be connecting a wire to one terminal of the 47 ohm resistor. The other end of the wire is connected to the terminal of the inductor. Just two terminals, I'll be connecting to one terminal. The value of inductance is 30 millihenry. The other end is connected with a wire and it is connected to one terminal of the capacitor whose value is 0.1 microfarad. From the other end of the capacitor, I'll be connecting a wire and it is connected to one of the terminal of the milliammeter. From the other terminal of the milliammeter, which is an AC milliammeter, I'll be connecting a wire and it is connected to the voltmeter, one of the terminals of voltmeter. From the other end of the voltmeter, I'll be connecting a wire and it is connected to the other end of the 47 ohm resistor. So the circuit is complete. So let us check for the connections. First, the resistor is connected to inductor and inductor is connected to capacitor and it is connected to ammeter and ammeter is connected to voltmeter and back to resistor. So all are connected in series. So the circuit is complete. Now we are going to connect the periodic voltage source parallel to the voltmeter. So I am connecting so that the voltmeter and the periodic voltage source are in parallel. Here the periodic voltage source is nothing but the signal generator or function generator. So we look onto the LCR trainer kit the connections we made. So this is the voltmeter and these are the terminals of the voltmeter. So I'll be taking one wire and connecting to one of the terminals of the voltmeter. I'll be taking another wire and connecting to that other terminal of the voltmeter. So two wires are taken parallel to the voltmeter. And this will be connecting to signal generator. In order to connect the signal generator or periodic voltage source parallel to the voltmeter, I'll be taking the output terminals of the signal generator. These are the positive and negative wires. And I'll be connecting to the two wires that I have connected earlier, which is parallel to the voltmeter. So the next procedure is to test whether the circuit connections are correct. For that, we turn on the signal generator and we turn the amplitude variable knob. And you can see when you turn, the amplitude is increasing. And here also, it is increasing. So I am turning till it reaches 4 volt on the voltmeter. So on the voltmeter, it is showing 4 volt. But if you are looking onto the signal generator, it is saying that it is producing 11.9 volt. So I will explain why there is a difference between the two. Since they are connected in parallel, both should give the same value. And if you are looking to the ammeter, it is also actually changing. The readings are changing, which means the circuit connections are fine. As we have already seen, the aim of the experiment is to find the effect of damping on a forced electrical oscillator. And it can be studied by using a frequency response graph. So from this experiment, we are going to plot a frequency response graph. So for plotting this graph, we require the frequency on the x-axis and the current along the y-axis. So the frequency information can be taken from the signal generator and the current information can be obtained from the ammeter or milliammeter on the LCR trainer kit. Before you make the observation, first of all, you have to understand the readings that is coming on the signal generator. So you can see sine. When you press the function button, it turns to triangle. Again, when you press the button, it turns to square, pulses, then TTL signals, and back to sine. So when you press the function button, the output it generates from the signal generator is changing. So now it is producing sine. So when you change the function, it will be producing square waves, pulses, etc. Now, if you are looking to the right, there will be two numbers, that is 0.9 kHz and 20 volt. So the unit says that 0.9 kHz is nothing but frequency and 20 volt means it is amplitude. So 0.9 kHz can be varied using the frequency variable. So if when you turn the frequency variable now, you can see the frequency is changing. The output frequency, that means it is generating a sine wave and its frequency is varied. Its amplitude is constant. Now you can vary the amplitude by turning the amplitude variable knob. So you can see, you can change the corresponding value. So this is how you generate the desired signal of particular frequency and amplitude. So you have to understand that the 2 volt shown here is not amplitude, it is peak to peak voltage. So half of this value is called as amplitude. So if it is showing 2 volt, the actual amplitude of the wave is 1 volt. So again, let me show how to generate a sine wave of a desired frequency and amplitude. So here you can see you are generating a sine wave because it is showing sine, and it is showing a 0.9 kHz frequency and 2 volt is the peak to peak value of voltage, which means 1 volt is the amplitude. So 0.9 kHz can be varied by turning the frequency variable knob, and the 2 volt, that is the amplitude, can be varied using amplitude variable. So let me show. When you turn the frequency knob, the frequency is changing. And in order to change the amplitude, you change the amplitude variable knob. So you can see you are changing the amplitude. And the output can be obtained from the output terminal. That is a BNC connector. So in order to get a frequency response curve as shown here, when you increase the frequency, the current should first increase and reaches a maximum value, that is called Imax. And thereafter, when you further increase the frequency, the current is going to decrease and comes to minimum value. So that is how you get a curve as shown in the figure. So we have to check whether we are getting a similar observation of current when you increase the frequency. So what you are expecting is, when you increase the frequency knob, that means you are increasing the frequency of the sine wave, the ammeter should show an increasing current, and it starts to increase and reaches a maximum value, and thereafter it should come back to the starting point or the minimum value. So we will check whether you can see such an observation from the circuit we have already created. Now let us check what happens to the current when you increase the frequency applied. So the change in current in the circuit can be obtained in the ammeter. So let's see what happens when you increase the frequency. So I am increasing the frequency slowly from 0.9 kHz. And as I'm increasing, you can see on the ammeter reading is going up and reaches a maximum and it is coming back. I'm continuously increasing the frequency, but after reaching a maximum current, it goes down to a minimum value. So this is what we get from the observation. So when you try to plot this information onto a graph by plotting frequency along the x-axis and the corresponding currents you observe on the y-axis, you will be getting a curve similar to this one. Then you can say that you are going to get a frequency response curve for a particular damping. That is, here we are using 47 ohm, L equal to 30 millihenry, and C is equal to, that is capacitance equal to 0.1 microfarad. So for this particular combination or particular values, you are getting a particular frequency response curve. Now you will be repeating the experiment so that you can see what happens to the frequency response curve, whether it is changing accordingly with the theory. So in the theory, you have seen, once you increase the damping by increasing the value of resistance, when you plot the frequency response, the sharpness gradually decreases. Again, when you increase the value of resistance, then you will be seeing the peak value or the sharpness is decreasing and finally becoming flat. So we have to test whether we are going to get a similar observation in real systems. So this is the table for tabulating the data, that is the frequency observed from the signal generator in kilohertz and the current observation from the ammeter in milliamperes. So using this data, you will be plotting the frequency response graph. That means the frequency will be coming along the x-axis and the current will be coming along the y-axis. So when you use this data or observation, then you will be getting the frequency response graph. When you plot the frequency response graph with resistance 47 ohm and 100 ohm and 150 ohm, you'll be getting a similar type of graph. So from this graph, you can differentiate between them. But in order to clearly express that difference, you have to express that change in terms of a quantifier called as quality factor. And we have already discussed how to find the quality factor from a given response curve. So you have to separately find the quality factor by the process already explained in the theory for the three graphs. So you will be getting the quality factor, a high value for a resistance equal to 47 ohm. Because of low resistance, the sharpness is more. So you are expecting to get a high value of quality factor. And for 100 ohm, when you find the quality factor, that quality factor will be less compared to that of 47 ohm. And for 150 ohm, you will be getting the least value among the three. So this is the result that you will be getting after doing the experiment. So by doing this experiment, we study the effect of damping on a forced electrical oscillator with the help of a frequency response graph. It is seen that As we increase the damping by increasing the value of resistance in the LCR circuit, the sharpness of the frequency response curve decreases. And this is also quantified using the measure called as quality factor or Q factor. So thank you. For more lectures, please visit the following link.